Governance, Elections, Advocacy and Research Services GEARS Initiative Zambia, in conjunction with ActionAid Zambia, has embarked on a campaign dubbed
Operation Save the Constitution.
We say no coalition government,
no deputy ministers,
no removal of workers on payroll before paying their benefits,
no election of mayors, chairpersons, by councillors, but residents.
No 2 years resignation for civil servants to participate in active partisan politics.
No to NDF resolutions in the Constitution.
Support the campaign. Talk to your MP to say
no two-third majority
in Parliament for the NDF Draft Constitution Bill 2019. Join the campaign now and be counted. It's
Operation Save the Constitution.
GEARS, Voice of Democracy and Electoral Integrity.
That's why it could be the House of Chiefs. Every day, the Kesha Pathy and Tap, that your former House of Chiefs, who I think it's a white elephant, but if you're a woman, every resolution to read on Tonka and Yoko, but Gary of Ma, fully Moon and Muriba, Moon and Mo NTF, but what if you're a pan and power open, then you pay or got your present, ever got a pukula from Nicola Pera, Macacola, Chitari, organize it, Naniba Shamfumo, no Kubach Gazette. If you are to live for if you prefer if you favor if you wish for Mukwe Quatra, a Makanga of Matri traditional leaders.
That is a voice of Chief Chisunka of Mansa in Luapula province on the provision in the Constitution of Zambia Amendment Bill of 2019 that talks about traditional leadership and their recognition. It is clear that some traditional leaders in the country are concerned with what those that sat at the Mulongoshi International Conference Center decided during the National Dialogue Forum, NDF.
Ya kwe ba chuko ba by election ku kampera fe mumutende uchita fe shani ukula bombera fe chapa bu then abe ne oba sara uya wini ni shidu yu chet pero ukula nda nga fwe ba shan fu mpatu nga bata wale fintu ama le chukina mu ni fwe ba ni fwe ba ni pa grassroot levu so ifwe kwa li tontoka ni kwa 10 TF ili mbia fwe ya ra kwa fwe nisho kusolveni aliyama issues kuchilo kula leta mwifu wale fwe okule ya leta mwifu ya ma deputy ministers hapa ni fwe bingara bomba tapa ni fwe ba bomba ma ministers fwe 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 ba ni fwe bena.
And a senior citizen based in Mongo and former Ngambela of Barosinand, Clement Sinyenda, has concerns over some resolutions from the NDF.
The oasis of dialogue is to solve an issue with the people that you don't agree with. For example, how do you actually discuss the constitution leaving out stakeholders like the three mother bodies, church mother bodies? How do you leave out UPND? Because these are big stakeholders and they must be involved every time.
Mr. Sinyenda, who is also former education deputy minister, further adds his concerns as he winds up with some advice for Zambians.
I want to advise strongly as a senior citizen that the whole issue of NDF should be started and I suggest that it should be the three church mother bodies that should chair this meeting, because we are trying to solve an issue.
Another senior citizen from Mongo shares his thoughts on the NDF.
The very presence of the MPs in the NDF, I found it myself as a very big anomaly. Because it is like a situation of you are setting up an examination, you write it, and you mark yourself. Because How do they go to parliament and turn back on what they had resolved at the NDF? So I find that as a very, very big anomaly.
Western Province is one of the poorest in the country, despite it having a number of endowments from natural elements such as the Zambezi River to its richness in culture and tradition. Hence, it is of concern to those that have Zambia at heart.
There are quite several issues, I think, in those resolutions that came from the NDF, which should not be entertained. Look at the issue of the people that have been working for government. They have rendered good service over the years. They retire, and the current law says that they should remain on the payroll until they are finally cleared. But now to say they should just leave immediately before they clear them, they will be going home with the empty pockets, and yet the PF was campaigning on the basis of more money in your pockets. I think that is just playing with the people's lives.
Traditional leadership is key in national development. Hence, Gears, in his continued campaign dubbed Operation Save the Constitution, visited Western Province and paid a courtesy call at Lialui, the palace of the Barusland King, Molena Lobosi Imwiko II. They met the Ngambela of the Prime Minister of Barusland, who welcomed the Gears team led by Mr. McDonald Chipenzi, the Executive Director, and later had a private meeting in which a number of issues were discussed. Further, Gears featured on local media, Liseli, Liambai, and Mungu FM radio stations to share with locals the developments from the NDF.
Taking process requires that its citizens get effectively engaged so that they refine the thinking, they refine the drafting, and they refine the outcome.
We have a challenge. Our focus of legislation is to strengthen and consolidate the political power. So if you look at the resolution from the NDF, you realize that the focus was more to do with consolidation of political power, and also you may also think that at the time of creating or coming up with the resolutions, they were also a shadow in mind to say that we are coming up with these laws because there is this shadow that is following us behind. This shadow must not do A, B, C, D, and say when we do this, the shadow will stop following us. It will vanish in the DDA.
Like in other provinces visited, that is Luapula and Copperbelt, Gears had a meeting in Mongo with various stakeholders based in the province. Their main aim was to look at the NDF resolutions and dissected them one by one.
Society realistic makes even our offsprings yet to come to find a peaceful environment to live in. Once the society misses reality and the dictates over truth, over reality, then you perish as a society. I also want to implore you to be very active and contributive, because, like you remember, there is one important person who I can't remember, but you maybe remember that he said, when people become silent over issues that affect them, then that is the end of their lives. And fortunately, with the help of McDonald's and your interest to participate, you are not going to be silent over the issues that affect us, regarding the outcome of the national dialogue.
Just on us to check ourselves whether we want to continue sleeping, or probably we should defend that which we need to defend so that we are able to keep the sovereignty of this nation and be able to uphold our constitution as Zambians.
The preamble that talks about Zambia being a Christian nation was first discussed.
We should remain multi-religious in that. We should have that choice. And as a Christian nation, If you feel that Zambia should be a Christian nation on its own, I feel the tolerance part does not come in. And if we say, let it just be a Christian nation, but we know that we are going to tolerate them and welcome them, then we are just pretending. Let it just be open, let the mouth religion part still remain the way it was. I don't have an issue with it from what I've observed.
Zambia must remain a Christian nation. Because even our forefathers, they were all Christians.
Some they were for removing it, some for remaining in it. So at the point we are now, we can't go back to say, was it one person declared? Later on, we, as a Zambia, we agreed through many discussions in the Mongomba and all those. Yes. So that one is already
gone.
Well, yeah.
Okay. What Christian? We have to follow the Bible. What is in the Bible? Than saying that it should be multi-religion is already declared. So what we have to do is to follow other Zambians, so that we follow what Jesus Christ has done for the world.
Was there some wider consultations like we are doing it now? Mm-hmm. Or it was just single-handedly I wake up, declare to say, this is what I want. If at all, there were no wider consultations, these are problems that we need to look at seriously.
We have been having a very good relationship with them. Now, if we are going to play around this issue because of politics, we should expect something to do with war. And Mr. Spence, you are aware that you are a civic education person at that level. With my little knowledge in civic education, we have to go deeper into these issues. So we expect all these things to come out. So if we are playing politics thinking that's a small issue, we are burying our heads in sand. So a lot of things are coming out of this. It's a very big discussion, it's a very big topic if we go into details. So if we are playing around the issue of constitution and we think that we are doing something that is good because we want to please certain individuals because of the votes that are coming in 2021, then we are fooling ourselves. So to me, really, it's a very big issue that we need to interrogate. We should not rush and say, no, we remove this, we want to put this and this. To me, really, I think we have to have a lot of time and do a lot of consultation than what happens at the NDF resolution.
Looking at the treaties that we have signed, that we have agreed with the others who have different beliefs. So all those issues should have been looked at before we finally say, no, we are out. Again, we change, we say, no, I think we made a mistake. If we say out, then the Muslims will be free. They will start building mosques and they will do what? No, I think we go back and say only the Christians. But again, it's not clear because for me, law is law. Immediately you miss even an A, it doesn't work. So we really need to look at how do we harmonize the fundamental rights where we have agreed with others in different countries with different beliefs before we declare ourselves Christians. Because even the Israelites themselves haven't yet reached the levels where we are now. That's why we see now we've just found ourselves in a way.
Election of members of parliament and other office bearers was also discussed. The proposed clause of introducing a coalition government was not spared. dissolution of parliament, but letting members of the House and ministers stay in their portfolios was well debated by the delegates.
Only dissolve at the date of the general elections, to allow members of parliament to complete their full 5-year term. You, the people, spoke. This is also the same with the ministers. They are saying parliament will not dissolve until the election day. But at the same time, they are saying councils will dissolve. But they were elected at the same time. So councils will dissolve, parliament will continue. So that the ministers continue to serve until the election day. You have a say, madam?
Yes. I say no to that, simply because those who are in power, they will have the upper hand to control the situation. In another way, they may say, denying these others to have the right to do what they are supposed to do. Because they will have the control. Yes.
They misuse the money because they will have access to transport, they will have access to fuel, they will have all the monies around them. Meaning that it is very easy for them, even maybe sometimes to start even campaigning even before, because they have access to resources. But if they are dissolved, it means all of them and the others will start at 0 point.
In case of a dispute in a presidential election, the current constitution has a provision for the presidential contender who has concerns on how the election was handled to go to court and seek legal redress. The current constitution only gives 14 days, but during the NDF sitting, the days were increased and made more clearer to 30 calendar days, and the congregation had its say on the matter.
We agree with the 30, but should be clear working days in the constitution. Are we agreeable on that one?
Yes.
Thank you. Let's move on.
The reintroduction of deputy ministers in government had its fair share of the debate, and the conclusion was reached.
Okay, so this is a clear no. No, not debatable.
No.
Okay.
Further, other submissions, such as a civil servant resigning 2 years prior to an election if they wish to contest, were also dissected.
Yes,
I think for me, on this one, I support it, because you know, a civil servant is there to save the people of Zambia.
Yeah.
He must give time frame to his bosses,
yeah,
to find somebody who take over from him. Other than he has been there for many years, and then he hears that tomorrow there's a nomination
day.
He says, no, me, I want you to go understand. I think that's no. Let's respect our jobs.
Okay.
Is it better to resign before, or a year or 2 years before that?
Okay.
What million has been given to a politician to be appointed into public service? What period is given? If I'm given 2 years as a civil servant, before you are appointed as a civil servant, what period has been given? If I'm clear on that one, then I'm
2 years' time is a long time. For them, they are saying that they should stay in office up to the election day. They have all the monies, all the vehicles, all the fuel. Now you resign in 2 years for you to... Are you able to compete with them?
We are rejecting that. We are also rejecting that.
So I reject it.
Okay.
We want the civil servants to be genuinely serving the people. When they've got political mind, they want to decide going to politics, give them time to go quickly.
Okay.
A member of parliament, it only needs one person. Not all the five that have given them 2 years, resigned 2 years ago to compete. It's, can't you see the disadvantage there? For me, I would, as time comes, you take the challenge. Not waiting, not waiting for 2 years. What for? And when you fail, nobody calls you your job.
We follow the same system. If it means 3 months notice, it's not like if my organization where I work, 3 months was good time. Because if I resign 2 years before election, elections is a very big undertaking. I need money. By the time it comes, I will be broke without money.
Only those with money will be able to enter into politics. When we look at the people with money, some have already saved and they have the experience, they even know how to do certain things. So if you bar them from entering into politics because they do not have money to for that 2 years to prepare themselves, so it means we'll be sending people there to be our representatives who are not even knowledgeable, they are not even educated. They don't, in the first place, they have not even gone to school, but they have opted this other way. Sorry to use that term. They are businessmen and so on. So at the end of the day, those will be our rulers and our leaders, while those, the technocrats that are educated, they always just be following. So we have a total confusion of our governance system. So in my views, the 2 years, it is too much. We need these learned people to also enter into these spaces.
Come and tell you to say that I want to join, I want to participate. It's like I've already, I started some 3 years ago supporting you. So that's out. For me to contest, if I want to contest 2016, it means I had already started here. But get it. Yes, I'm already prepared.
For me, 2018, it's too much. It's perhaps we can even reduce it maybe within maybe 3 or 6 months.
Okay. You want people to work for you, to organize the party for you. You just come and...
The time frame for campaign period that was changed by the National Dialogue Forum from 90 to 60 days was also put on the table.
For the opposition party, this will satisfy the ruling party at the expense of the opposition. Yes, it will be hard for the opposition to market its candidates, its manifestos to the electorate.
I'm still supporting the 90 days. Because some of our areas are very far. They are typical rural areas whereby even going there by a vehicle, it is hard. Now when you reduce it to 60 days, it will be not enough.
When you look at what's happening now, like the party in power, it's already campaigning. Now if they say that you will just give it 60 days, means advantage the opposition for them to campaign as well. So let's give it 90 days the way it is, which is enough for each one to go around and inform the electorates on what they want to do for them.
We have procedures. All we need to do is to formalize those procedures so that we don't have these stalemates that is happening in other places where you have two chiefs. One recognized by the traditional system, one recognized by the central government. We need to normalize this, we need to harmonize this, and we can only harmonize it if we put a law in place. Also,
harmonizing the statute and the customary law. Now, if we want to harmonize that, is this the way it should be done? Although there should be extensive consultative meetings with the traditional leaders, or is it that we who are here don't know when the chiefs meet there? Have they also agreed? Because they're supposed to tell us. Because those are the people, our representatives. Yes, yes.
We don't want this because the chiefs were there. Even when the government, even when this country was still. No, it's not a Rhodesia. Yes. The chiefs were there. So we don't want to intimidate our chiefs. No. Let them remain the way they are.
Now when they take it back to the old system, what they have, where the councillors now they start to choose who could be the council chairperson, who could be the mayor. Now we are trying now to defeat the purpose of who? Yes. Now I think for me I would say that we should just maintain whoever mayors and councillors.
The Western Province stakeholders, just like in other provinces, issued a communique at the end of the gathering.
Having carefully considered the proposed amendment, we have come to the conclusion that Zambia should uphold the Christian Declaration while tolerating the existence of other religious groupings. we in the Western Province propose that the Public Order Act must facilitate enjoyment of people's rights and freedoms. We reject the proposed adoption of the principle for the formation of coalition government. Regarding this issue of withdrawing of chieftains' recognition, traditional institutions must be allowed to exercise their powers according to existing customary procedures. We regret that the proposed Constitutional Bill of 2019 is intended to take power away from traditional authorities. We uphold the provision in the current constitution as provided for in Article 165 of the 2016 amended constitution. Power to recognize and withdraw must never be vested in the executive. In conclusion, as the stakeholders in Western Province, we would say that the proposed Constitutional Bill of 2019 falls far below the minimum threshold for establishing a national law that promotes human rights and freedoms for all citizens. Most provisions that have been proposed have been tailored for self and political preservation. There seem to be no genuineness, as most of the provisions are politically centered with little power to the citizens. I thank you.
Governance, Elections, Advocacy and Research Services GEARS Initiative Zambia, in conjunction with ActionAid Zambia, has embarked on a campaign dubbed
Operation Save the Constitution.
We say no coalition government,
no deputy ministers,
no removal of workers on payroll before paying their benefits,
no election of mayors, chairpersons, by councillors, but residents.
No 2 years resignation for civil servants to participate in active partisan politics.
No to NDF resolutions in the Constitution.
Support the campaign. Talk to your MP to say
no 2/3 majority
in Parliament for the NDF Draft Constitution Bill 2019. Join the campaign now and be counted. It's
Operation Save the Constitution.
GEARS, Voice of Democracy and Electoral Integrity.